Welcome to the Doctorate in Educational Leadership's Speaker Series. I'm Julian Vasquez Heilig, Director of the Doctorate in Educational Leadership at California State University, Sacramento. We're so pleased to have our final speaker of 2017. We've had some really incredible luminaries here this year. You can watch their videos on our YouTube channel and on our Facebook channel. We've had Linda Darling Hammond from Stanford University. We've had Terrence Green from the University of Texas at Austin, and several other really interesting and engaging speakers. And today, I'd like to welcome those of you that are here on campus today, and all those that are watching live on Facebook Live, and also those of you that are watching in perpetuity on YouTube. We're so honored to welcome Dr. Cheryl Matias, and I got that right, didn't I? Dr. Cheryl Matias, she's currently an associate professor of urban community and teacher education at the University of Colorado at Denver. In her talk today, she's going to talk about The Time Is Now, Dismantling Whiteness in Education. She'll be speaking about the recent rise in white nationalism in the United States, as well as issues of race, racism, and how education can be a transformative tool to enact change. Dr. Matias has many, many honors, so I will just give you just a few of them. She's received the Innovations in Research on Diversity and Teacher Education Award from the American Educational Research Association, Division K, and she's received the University of Colorado's Rosa Parks Diversity Award. She was also the 2015 UC Colorado School of Education and Human Development Researcher of the Year. And she's also my Facebook friend. So without further ado, Dr. Cheryl Matias, and I won't shake her hand because she has a cold and I don't want to have a cold for the holidays, but we're so glad you're here and we're so glad that you brought also your beautiful children.
Hello, Sac State. How you doing?
Good. Good.
Thank you.
I come on the one day and I bring the clouds, so, you know, I'll bring you some whiteness, I guess. Yes, I'm an associate professor at the University of Colorado Denver. Recently published my book, Feeling White. A lot of my work delves into race and education and racially just education, teacher education, and education writ large. I'm also do a lot of work with Mother Scholar and Women in the Academy, so that's another avenue of my scholarship that I focus on. So with that said, I'm just going to present some of the overall works, some of my research, and then I was hoping we can have just a little bit of Q&A afterwards to talk about it. So with respect to that, I will begin my presentation. The Time Is Now, Dismantling Whiteness in Teacher Education. In this photo, you see the Charlottesville protest, riot, whatever you want to call it. But we definitely see in the United States, it's nothing new, but it is a return to the rise of white nationalism. So I wanted to talk about the current racial state of our nation, because this is statistics, and these are just things that we've heard Black Lives Matter, but we need to understand why it does. We're seeing that 210 and to 166 Hispanics have been fatally shot by police in 2017 thus far. We also know that white male comprise the largest racial group and gender group that commit mass shootings. We have seen a spike and rise, a steadily rise since 2014 of racial hate groups. Since 2015, 197% increase in anti-Muslim hate groups. So we're seeing a lot of bigotry, intolerance, racism, and prejudice being it never left, but it's being melted to the top again. And I wanted to talk a little bit about the local state of race to bring Sacramento into this picture. Because Sacramento in the Bay located in California, which is considered the left best coast, right? I'm born and raised in California. I'm a little bit biased, but I am a Southern Cali girl, so. But you know, as open and minded as we proclaim to be, we have to understand that there are rises in white nationalism in California, particularly in the Bay Area as well, rallies increasing. In fact, in one of your local news reports, it has increased that 79 of the hate groups are found in California, California being one of the largest. And you would often think that, oh, these hate groups could be found in the South. And if you ever read Dr. Ricky Lee Allen's work on whiteness, white Southerners, poor white Southerners to be exact, are often characterized as the portraiture of racist, when that is not the case, right? So it's very much a very real and salient issue in our local Sacramento community as well. So then it brings me to question then. What is the role of education? Do we sit idly by and allow this to happen? I like to draw from John Dewey, our founder, a philosopher of education, to kind of posit this inquiry. He writes, what avail is it to win prescribed amounts of information about geography and history, to win ability to read and write, if in the process the individual loses his own soul? What then is the true meaning of preparation in the educational scheme? And I think about this work particularly because in the same vein, we're having a focus on test scores, AYP. We're having a focus on mastery, proficiency. That's the rhetoric that goes in teacher education. That's the rhetoric that invades educational leadership. That's the rhetoric that is imprinted on educational policies. And this is the type of educational schema that we are molding education to be. Yet we know in our social landscape that these atrocities are happening around us. So what is our role if our soul is being lost beyond these test scores? And knowing that there's an increasing amount of hate groups, we need to start thinking about education as a transformational resistance, as a tool to educate the mind, the heart, and I would go back to Dewey, the soul. So there's various theories. I know it's getting a lot of sexiness and vogue to talk about critical race theory and the critical whiteness studies, but I just wanted to break it down really simply because oftentimes when I get doctoral students, when they want to study, let's say, African-American educational pipelines or Latinx cohorts, or they want to study about Asian-American Pacific Island graduation rates, oftentimes they're thinking, oh, well, I'm talking about race, right? So I'm doing critical race theory, am I not? No. There's various theories to investigate race. You can go into sociology of race, you can do a philosophical approach to race, like feminism. I'm just gonna pin out two here just to kind of, and this is a very simplification of it, but just so it's very clearly understood, that one of them is critical race theory, which is an analytical tool that was drawn from legal studies that is now applied to education to investigate how white supremacy and racism manifest in our educational system, whether it's policies, doctrines, teaching practices, and so forth, right, and curriculum. So there's critical race theory. Critical whiteness studies is very similar, as you can see on both of the T-charts there. A lot of them deals with the centrality of race. And I like to just focus this, and like I said, this is an oversimplification, just so that it's very clear. That CRT has a focus on how people of color experience race in a racist society. Whereas critical whiteness studies focuses on how whites experience race in a white supremacist society. It's like hitting both sides of the coin, so to speak. I often tell my feminist in the room, we cannot understand sexism. We cannot understand the roots of misogyny, rape culture, and what we deal with as women in the workplace and in our homes and on the streets and society, unless we understand the overarching mechanisms of patriarchy. So in the same vein, when we study racism, we understand racism impacts and oppresses people of color, yet what is it that allows that to happen? And that's the whole notion of white supremacy and whiteness. And I'll get to that in my next slides. So a lot of the words, whenever I teach about race, and I'm pretty sure you get this as well, the first thing in popular speak is the first thing people say when they experience racism is, that's so racist, right? Without even a thorough understanding of, is it really racist? Or I felt it could have been racist. Was that racist? So I'm just gonna pick on critical race theory uses this. They drew a lot from counseling, but the word racial microaggression, right? For these are these daily subtle slights that are given to people of color that are regardless of intent. I think that's really important. It's the impact of how that is felt. I use in terms of gender, it's the, oh, you must be on your period. So see, and I see smiles in this guy. But yes, it's that subtle slight that have are laden with value, right? So here I have a quote from Sui Tal's work talking about racial microaggressions are brief and commonplace daily verbal, behavioral, or environmental indignities, whether intentional or unintentional, that communicate hostile, derogatory, or negative racial slights and insults towards people of color. I would include later in my slides also emotional. So the question then is this. What then is preceding racial microaggression such that we are experiencing racial oppression? Correct? There must be something, the XY factor, sorry for my math educators if I don't have that perfectly correct, but there's a variable that remains constant for it to be enacted, such that this condition applies in society. So my argument is whiteness is that constant, right? So then what is whiteness? A lot of people conflate white privilege, whiteness, and white supremacy in the same breath. They are very much different. It's just like saying how racial microaggressions may be different from racism, how we construct and understand racism, how we construct racial battle fatigue. There's actual vocabulary, but because of the fact that we don't talk about race so often, we've almost developed a speech impediment, and then we end up with those two words, that's racist, to articulate a whole myriad of thought, feeling, and history, right? So here's one of my pieces that I conceptualize, what is whiteness? And here I write, if blackness is a social construction that embraces black culture, languages, experiences, identities, and epistemologies, then whiteness is a social construction that embraces white culture, ideology, racialization, expressions and experiences, epistemology, emotions, and behavior. However, here's the big caveat. Unlike blackness, whiteness is normalized because white supremacy elevates whites and whiteness to the apex of the racial hierarchy. So when you're having those diversity trainings, and they say, well, everyone brings in a perspective to the table, that's a falsity. Because everyone does bring a perspective, yet there's a power relationship for which one perspective is always given credence over another. I want to be very clear, because we get that in a lot of educational leadership, we get that in a lot of educational policies, that we're looking at diversity and inclusion. Well, the problem here is we're not being included, nor is our voice really being heard. So I want to be very clear of what whiteness can encapsulate. So here is kind of a chart to see how these things all interrelate. When I was a grad student at UCLA, Danny Solorsono, my professor, used to say, racism is not the problem. Racism is not the disease, it's the symptom. white supremacy is the actual disease. We would not have racism if there weren't white supremacist thinking and white supremacist structures. So when I'm thinking of that, well then how can we conceptualize this so that we understand how this impacts society? Here in this chart, it's taken from my book, which is in the back. So white supremacy impacts both whites and people of color, albeit in various ways. For whites, it impacts them through the process of whiteness. And there are there's a multitude of elements of whiteness. Now, when we're talking about people of color, they experience white supremacy through racism, and there's various dynamics of racism. Now, whiteness can impact people of color, albeit in a different way. So I want to talk a little bit about why it's so important to acknowledge the elements of whiteness when we're talking about white supremacist structures, especially in education. The phenomenon that we're starting to notice is very much similar to Eduardo Bonilla Silva's book, The Racism Without Racist. Now everyone with a progressive or liberal mind can say, yes, there's institutional racism in educational systems. Great. I think it's kind of like a catchphrase. It's kind of like skinny jeans. You know, you wear it to rock it and look good, but you secretly hate to even wear it, right? So when we're talking about the elements of whiteness, what we're seeing here is a lot of people can say, well, yes, white supremacy is, there's institutional white supremacy. But when we're thinking about, well, why does it manifest? No one ever wants to take onus. So we've gotten the same dynamics as Bonilla Silva's, racism without racism. So we got white supremacy without ever acknowledging that white supremacist ideals and whiteness behaviors that uphold white supremacy is still individually happening. So when I look at the elements of whiteness here, and I like to separate that very apart from what we usually conceptualize, because I know the first thing we conjure up is racist. A neo-Nazi, a KKK member, or whatever the likes. You have to remember, even neo-Nazis have said and gone on record saying they don't believe they're racist. They just believe whites are superior.
Right.
Okay? They have said that. Yep. So we really need to understand this a little bit better. So when I'm talking about elements of whiteness, we're talking about some of these things that we see. Color blindness, right? White privilege. Entitlement. Materialization, naturalization, we're talking about even real estate, historical wealth accumulation, we're talking about all of those individual acts, right? Not necessarily intentional, not necessarily malintent, not necessarily a skinhead, but these are things that support whiteness, which ultimately support white supremacy. I want to go back clear to say this. I like to tell the story of one of my students. One of my former students was a retired Air Force, and her partner was retired Army. And I remember her telling me the story about how she went to Target with her partner, and she parked, and a woman next to her, immediately was a mother with a kid, parked right next to her. And immediately, my student got out and started screaming. She's like, what are you doing? She's screaming. And the mother's like, what? I'm just a little over the line, no big deal, you know, no big deal. Turns out, her husband moves with a wheelchair. My student's husband. And so he couldn't get out of the car to go to Target because this mother decided to park a little bit over the line, which meant nothing. She had no bad intent. She's not a skinhead, right? She wasn't a hateful person, but yet she engaged in ableist thinking and engaged in behaviors and actions, which thus oppressed another person. So these are some, when I talk about these elements of whiteness, I want to be very clear that regardless to intent, and some of them can be intentful, but these are some of the accumulations of wealth, accumulations of privileges that then impact white supremacy. And they can impact people of color. So I get a lot of folks who say, well, is it only white people? Are you only saying, No, because I'm talking about whiteness. And whiteness can very much inhabit the mindsets of people of color.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Albeit through different means. So I'm not going to let whites off the hook, because they do benefit from whiteness ideology, right? But at the same time, people of color who are trying to survive in a white supremacist world will have to engage in what we will call white norm behaviors such that they can make it ahead, right? This is what in the communities of color we call the coconut, the Twinkie, and the ding-dong. You know, you're brown on the outside, white on the inside. So although it comes at an undue cost, as Frantz Fanon has written about, it comes with a dependency complex, a lot of self-esteem, and internalized or racist ideas about one's own self. So these are some of the impacts that it has, both on people of color and on whites. So I have here a list, and I'm not going to go through all of them. And we can talk about them if you very much. I have citations here if you'd like to further discuss them. But these are examples of whiteness in various aspects. I recently put out a publication, which I'll talk about later, that kind of goes into how whiteness is impacted in the current rhetoric of today's world, post-45. And here you'll have, we talk about education, the curricula, reform policies, pedagogies, instructional strategies, and teaching population are all examples of whiteness in view, right? And we talk about history, we talk about politics, religion, and even the language, the hegemony of English, correct? But what I wanted to focus on is emotionalities. So emotions, what emotions are, somewhat what we get in the classroom when we're trying to finally engage an honest conversation about race. I don't like to say the courageous conversation, because the only one who's really being courageous is the folks who have to hear it over and over again, you know? So emotional reactions like defensiveness, guilt, anger, sadness, vehemence, denial, silence, even emotionally freezing. All of those are that psychoanalytically stem from a long history of suppressing the reality of race and feeling shamed for such suppression. So Thondika writes a lot about how whites do know a lot about race. Not this whole teacher education where I just need an epiphany to know about race and I won't be racist anymore. It doesn't work that way. I always like to say, well, then why didn't you bring your black boyfriend home? They know a lot about race. Why did you drive on the other side of town to get home? You know? So I talk about these emotions very specifically in education, because these are the ones that often don't get us to a better spot where we can actually have an academic and intellectual dialogue about it. So here, what is the emotionality of whiteness? And I just quickly write it saying, the emotionality of whiteness encompasses all the emotions one feels to exert the hegemonic dominance of whiteness. So I even included in the slide before, emotional frozenness. And I wrote a piece, if anyone seen, I have a book chapter on this, but another publication is coming out. But I call it White Tundra, the emotional frozenness of whiteness. But in this chapter, I talk about even the silence, because there's a power structure already at play, that the very silence of not engaging in the discussions of race will work in a way to uphold whiteness ideology. You know, it's just like, I'm not going to engage with you. So someone could say, well, no, we really need to talk about this. Oh, no. It's just a total silencing, a total dismissing. So, and this can be manifested in various ways. And you might have heard this in the classroom, like, I've never owned slaves. You know, you've heard that. Why are you making me feel so bad? Maybe you're just being too sensitive. It's not about race. I have black friends. I'm not white anymore. I want to be called a pink Irishman. And I've gotten these from teacher educators. So we're talking about the professors who train, quote unquote, socially just teachers, right? Of course, there's a lot of social justice that goes on, but if we're not talking about race, we're being a eunuch, meaning the lack of balls to talk about race. So emotionality of whiteness very, very specifically. Because without ever engaging with our emotions, without ever acknowledging from where they so stem, without even identifying them in the moment as they happen, we can never get to an honest discussion or honest learning about race. I think anyone in this room can go back in their repertoire of experiences with human beings and partners and lovers and know that sometimes when we're consumed in an argument with a significant other, a close loved one, we often get very flustered with our emotions. And I don't know, let's just pick a topic. Maybe so-and-so is mad at, let's be stereotypical, a heteronormed heterosexual relationship and the girl's saying, I'm mad at your behavior at the party last night. And he comes back and he says, well, you're just jealous. I'm like, what the? Here's a good example of how when you don't ever identify what is it that the emotion comes, you start displaying defensive emotions and you never get to the actual emotion. Rather than saying, it really hurt me that and I felt abandoned when you took the time to speak with all the other folks at the party and you neglected your time with me. And I wanted that to be a space for us to come together and have fun with our friends. How easy is that? But that's not what usually happens, correct? So I do that same thing with teacher education because oftentimes, in all of education, we're always saying social justice. We need to do this. We need to be transformative. We need to be resistance. We need to be doing this. Yet, if we don't have the emotional ovaries to withstand what it takes to get in those dialogues, and we just emotionally react with defensiveness, we're actually not doing it any justice. I've had students say to my face, so what, they're racist. Trust me, it's not an easy task to accept, but at the same time, I'm their teacher. And I have a duty not only to them, I have a duty to the K-12 students they will teach. And so I have to have the emotional ovaries to withstand and teach and continue to push my students so that they can learn. So this is particularly what I'm telling us to do. So I do have a piece that just came out on equity and excellence in education. I am dabbling a little bit more. Teacher education has a lot of empirical data. I am dabbling a little bit more with hermeneutics and theoretical research methods. So this particular piece, The Illusion of Freedom, Tyranny, Whiteness, and the State of U.S. Society, goes over how emotionality, epistemology, and rhetoric in U.S. society post-45, using examples of the campaign, kind of went through the filtered ocular of whiteness. And I've even included semiotics in there because I like nerdy stuff. But I didn't know how to put the ball inside the filter, so I just put it there. It's just how our thoughts, our speech, even our emotions are impacted by whiteness such that we are given the illusion of freedom when we're actually having the tyranny of a majority. I'm just gonna keep it really short because I do want us to have dialogue. And I say, oops, and the slide didn't show. Show's on here. Why is this so important now than ever? Well, I wanna be very clear. Someone did ask me 3 years ago at the American Educational Studies Association conference back in San Antonio. They asked me, is it getting worse? I said, the atrocities that are happening to black and brown bodies, particularly to black folks in the United States of America, has never ceased to exist. It has always remained the same. What's the atrociousness is the desensitization, how people capture it on iPhones and can watch it without batting an eye. I recently told my students, I finally watched Fruitvale Station just a year, 2 years ago. I watched it. And I had, has anyone watched it? This is your neck of the woods, man. You gotta watch it. Now go home and watch it. That's homework. No. Fruitvale Station starts with real footage. I must warn you of that. It doesn't tell you that in the very beginning. So I just put on the DVD, I started watching, and in the very beginning you see the actual footage of Oscar Grant dying. And I immediately pressed pause. I had the remote. I freaked out. The saddest part of today's society is we can watch a high school female student get beat up by a security guard so badly over a telephone, and we could just say, oh, that's so messed up, and post it and forward it on our Facebook. Rather than truly feeling the humanity of that student or the humanity of Oscar Grant. So I do this because there's too many lives at loss right now to be focused on not doing it, and that is our role. So I leave us with some directions. These are just overarching. How can we begin? You know, oftentimes race does fall in the cracks. So I want to push race to the forefront. I even have, for those of you that are interested in teacher education or ed leadership, I do actually have a lesson plan template, and I do have some publication on how to take California state standards and translate them into race-based critical race a lesson objective. So I do have some of that. But here are some of the things that I think we need to be thinking about all the time. Where in our syllabus do we directly engage race? What objectives have you set to dismantle the white supremacy? How are your readings diversified by authors of color? And that's nothing new. Bell Hooks has been saying that since 1994 in Teachings to Transgress. Do you clearly point out other theories, ideas, and perspectives, and how they've been marginalized, and why? How have you addressed whiteness directly in your syllabus? How have you gained enough vocabulary to discuss race and whiteness, which is the biggest thing, content knowledge specific? We gotta front load those vocabulary, or else they'll just say those two words. That's racist. Are you reaching out to collaborate with scholars who do racially just work to guest present in your class? Do you keep in mind that power structures are existing in your classroom and actively trying to dismantle them? And if so, how are you doing that? I often tell my students, I do get a lot of females in education, and they're like, well, I don't understand this, you know. I said, okay, let me put it this way. Let's say you're taking a course on feminism, and you walk into the class, and it's all male students, it's a male professor, and all the readings are by men. Do you feel safe to have a courageous conversation? Absolutely not. So I always like to remind, and I say this in my book, I give facilitator guidelines on how to do this, but to focus that there is already a power structure. It doesn't cease to exist the minute we step over a threshold of the classroom door. So acknowledging that happens, because oftentimes, and I see this with my students, actually I'll tell you, I'll wrap them out a little bit. Let me give you a little short story. I had a doctoral class. We had just finished reading Dr. Leonardo's Race, Education, and Whiteness. And they're sitting there going, you know, on page this, did you guys read this quote? On this page, did you think of this? Oh, that made me think of this. An engaging conversation, correct? That happened for 30 minutes until one white woman came to the middle and finally said, started crying and saying she doesn't feel safe to talk about this. And after she made, with her tears, all of a sudden, I had a Native American student who said, well, I never feel safe, you know, blah, 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 as a Native person. Then I had a black woman say, well, as a black woman, I never feel safe, you know. Then I had a Jewish woman say, well, trying to teach her, you know, not all of us, you know, And I let them go, I just let them have their go at it. And finally, they spent 27 minutes, you know, and they looked at the professor and they said, okay, well, Dr. Matias, like looking at me, what to do next, you know, when they give you that look as a professor, like,
you're in charge, right?
Yeah, you're in charge, right? And I looked at them, I said, thank you very much for showing how easily we all placate the emotionalities of whiteness. Class is over. And I wanted to do that specifically because it's so easy to cater to these emotions rather than get to the actual conversation that needs to be had. And so I leave that story with you to ponder in your own classes and in your own racially just discussions in education. And if you need me, some of the slides aren't showing, but it does say salamat po, mil gracias, and thank you on the top. But there's my information. I am in sabbatical in California for the whole school year, so you could probably reach me on Pacific Standard Time. Yeah. So, with that, if you have any questions, or we can meet individually, whatever you feel more comfortable with. Yes, question.
Well, I have a question. So, I just wrote a piece today in the Progressive magazine about free speech on campus. You know, there's the piece where about public bringing in public speakers, Nazis, white supremacists. Then you, of course, have the case of Betsy DeVos, where she was at Harvard and the students held up the white supremacist sign as a protest against her policies, right? So what do you think about, you know, and Rick has characterized this as a promiscuous use of the word white supremacy, right? Mm-hmm. So what do you think about this sort of balance, the butting of heads of people who think that we should engage in these conversations, people who think that we shouldn't engage in these conversions at all, that Nazis shouldn't be allowed in campus. What do you think about?
So my question was about how do we balance this like demand from, if I could give it in one sentence, how do we balance this conversation about
freedom of expression for people who are conservative and want to see white supremacists and Nazis either speak on campus or be empowered to speak in courses?
You know, I think there's a confusion. Because, yes, we live in a land of free speech, yet it's not ahistoric. You know, it's I think it's becoming, and I wrote this in a recent paper, that piece, Tyranny and the Illusion of Whiteness, I make the same argument that a lot of things are hiding behind free speech, but it's ahistorical. For example, I think it's a perverse reappropriation of civil rights terminology applied onto an ahistorical understanding of current day. So I'll give you an example. Kim Davis, right? The county register, who wouldn't issue a marriage license. Oh, yeah. To a couple who was gay, right?
Yeah.
And then she later was said, well, it infringed upon my religious rights, and then she likened herself to Martin Luther King. Okay. And this is exactly what I'm saying. It's a perverse reappropriation, reapplication of civil rights terminologies and concepts onto a social situation of today that is ahistorical, as if there's no history. You can say, for example, Nazi free speech can happen, but at the same time, it'll be delusional for you to think that there's no historical backing or events that has happened from that free speech. You see what I'm saying? So I think we need to be very careful. And when I talk about, I don't even think about conservative or liberals in this respect. I think about parents, you know? Parents don't want to talk to their kids about race, right? Well, they don't want to talk to their kids about sex. They didn't want to talk about their kids about drugs in the 80s. Well, guess what? We need to be educators for tomorrow. And if that conversation is not going to be had at home, it's going to be had in a public domain, so that we can have a very healthy conversation about it. And they can make their choices afterwards.
You know what? After they know, well, hey, you want to still be a racist, then go on with your bad self. Get away from me, though. You know? But the conversation needs to be had. And that's where we come in as educators. We need to take that role. We are supposed to be change agents of society. Well, let's do the change.
Ask a question about charter schools and the encroachment, not just in general public schools in general, but in particular of teacher education programs, and with in general the rather segregated nature of the classroom of a typical charter school. Now that when they're involved in the teacher preparation programs and more heavy recruiting for teachers, are we to conclude that these conversations of critical race are not taking place as often as they should?
I think it'd be dangerous to assume that who is taking the right conversation and what context is it doing. But I am at the same time very skeptical of large scale diversity and inclusion programs that really don't include marginalized voices, you know, and it becomes very difficult. Like, I literally sit at the University of Colorado, you know, all three, four campuses, and it's called the Ethnic Minorities Affair. Although the faculty, it's about racial justice and faculty of color, want to call it, you know, race and justice for faculty of color. We had one white woman who said, no, I think we should keep it Ethnic Minority Affairs. And then it kept. It's like, are you kidding me? Like, the dialogue, what is the point of a dialogue if it doesn't want to be heard? You know? So regardless of whether it's happening in charter schools, I know there's a lot more for-profit teacher education pipelines, which I can be skeptical because of, and I'm not saying all of them again, but we know how neoliberal regimes work, and we know how their hands and their tentacles get entrenched in some of the work that we're trying to do, regardless of politics and corporatization. So I think it's really important to be very cautious about that and be critical about that, and then just push the conversation, you know? So it's kind of roundabout answer for yours.
I had another question. You know, one of the hottest topics this fall, of course, has been the NFL protests, the kneeling, and then sort of the appropriation of those protests for all the different purposes, even though they were originally against police brutality and white supremacy, if you ask Kaepernick, right? What do you think about that discourse, how society has dealt with that discourse, how sports fans have dealt with that discourse?
I think I found the coolest meme to that one. They said, go ahead and ignore our kneeling just as you ignore police brutality. Which is pretty much society's response, right? It's all of a sudden becomes a big idea when someone asserts their humanity. When someone that in a white supremacist society is not given human status, is only given 3/5 of a white human status. Be very clear here. When they assert their humanity, when they assert their identity, when they assert their livelihood, all of a sudden it becomes an attack on something, correct? We have Beyonce who comes out and does a Super Bowl homage to the Black Panther Party. And all of a sudden you got, I'm gonna say white America, but whiteness America, saying, what? You're black? You're supposed to perform in the way in blackface that we like, you know? So I really think this is, the way society is reacting right now is just a larger, is a more open and a more real depiction of what people are already thinking in their hearts. So I think in order to have these conversations, sometimes it has to be direct. And I'm very patient. I've had one student who constantly, like, you know, it's gaslighting. That's what it is, if you think about it. It's gaslighting you to believe that you are humanly unworthy to present your own identity in the way you show socially fit. and that if you do, that you are a pariah to social norms, right? So if you're thinking about that, that's exactly what's happening in this society. But now we're calling out the gaslighting. So call it out. I hate that term unapologetic, where they use it with Beyonce and Colin Kaepernick. What do we have to be apologetic for? It's the question. So, they often say that about me. Like, you're so unapologetic. I'm a researcher. Yes, sir.
Thank you for your presentation. There was a recent CSU-wide symposium focused on what was called our graduation initiative, so our effort to eliminate the so-called achievement gap, right, and to improve our degree attainment rates. And the closing keynote speaker challenged the administrators in the room to do a number of things in their efforts to achieve that goal, and one of them was eliminating equity and competence. So I'm wondering about how, you know, with your work in particular, working with educators in the K-12 system, how do you see your work being able to infiltrate higher education and faculty across various disciplines? Because the kind of content that you're providing is directly related to, I think, that equity and competence elimination strategy.
Well, I think I'm gonna take higher ed and just put it into the K-12, just to show, because I've done the work on the K-12, not on the higher ed. But the same rhetoric circulates in the K-12 sector in terms of the racial achievement gap, right? Because black and brown students are falling far behind their white and Asian counterparts, right? So you have all these race-based symptoms, right? But you can't heal a problem by addressing a symptom. You must go directly to this disease, which I said in the very beginning with my professor. If you're not talking about white supremacy and how whiteness manifests in academia, then you're not really addressing the disease that create the symptoms, which is the achievement gaps, right? So I like to use I was a bio major. You can ask me that in another life. But it's like putting a Band-Aid on a skin lesion. And you're continually putting a Band-Aid and antibiotics on a skin lesion, which will eventually heal, but it will come back because you're not addressing the underlying skin cancer. So it's the same goes with achievement gaps, graduation rates, and all so forth. Until you address, for example, in K-12, until you examine how testings have racial bias since the bell curve, how standardized curriculum has been norms for white racial norms, right? If you're gonna talk about pedagogical aptitudes, and you're gonna talk about how certain behaviors of students are accepted while in other races they are not, which then produces an overrepresentation of black and brown students in special ed, and an overrepresentation of white and Asian students in gifted and talented. I mean, we're not gonna ever get to those issues until we talk about how whiteness is normed in our educational systems. And sometimes pointing it out is so raw, and people get emotional over it, rather than say, okay, let's identify these key things in whiteness that is happening, and let's see how we can change that up. So if we're not gonna change the canon, then it's not gonna make any difference. You could have all your little side things, and it'll do a little bit of help in a small little portion of population, but if our goal as educators, as social transformers, is to really make the society more equitable, then we really need to think of the underlying pillars that are holding up our educational system.
The conversation that you need to have, instead of just placating white emotionality about the discussion around white supremacy. Can you say any more about how you do that?
Pedagogically.
In your work. Yeah, as you train.
I do write it a little bit in my book, so I give some strategies on that. But I know it was just a one-liner about acknowledging that power structures continue to happen beyond the threshold of the classroom. I know that was just a one-liner, but it's a very serious consideration we have to do as all educators. Because the minute we our students step into this space, and then of course someone's crying because they feel bad, I need to always put that, Dr. Robin DiAngelo's work clearly show that some of the fears that white students had as opposed to the fears that black and brown students were having were sentimentalized and the other one was tangible. And that's why I keep talking about ahistorical. Women can say this, like when we're pregnant, we're afraid to say we're pregnant because we can lose our job, and that's what happens historically. So we can't think ahistorically. We need to understand that there's a history as to why certain things have happened, so we need to keep that in mind when we're in the classroom so that we can constantly combat it. So when the tears are happening, constantly thinking, well, this is not on par to the fact that I'm afraid my son might not come home. Exactly. That deep breath is exactly like, okay, well, I understand, and it's not to say I'm dismissing the tears. Like I said, it actually comes from a deep-rooted psychoanalytic issue, right? Because all of a sudden, like, you got a lot of white people saying, I don't see race, but they're crying. That's a real visceral response. That means it's something deeply rooted, right? The shame, or what Dondika calls white ethnic shame. So, and that's something real, but at the same time, it's understanding that that shame is not on par to some of the atrocities we're seeing today. And then as educators, we need to make that, we need to mitigate that, we need the students to realize that, and we need to push them through that. For my white students, I often say, you have to do the work on yourself in order to engage. A lot of white, diversity trainings, they always say, oh, just move past it. Well, they can't move past it if they don't even know where it's coming from. They just keep crying, or they're angry, or, you know, these are real emotions that are stemming from something that has traumatized them in the past. So, yes, sir.
Good evening. So I'm a K-12 administrator, I work in the central office, and what you just mentioned made me think of some of the work that we're engaged in, you know, with regards to the achievement of our black and brown students. You mentioned guilt or shame, you know, and how do, if they don't feel, so some of our young teachers who don't feel a connection to the past, often will get defensive, like you mentioned before, like, I'm not, like, don't put that on me, that wasn't me.
I never owned slaves, right?
Yeah, I never owned slaves, I have black friends. So, and even in some of my conversation with them, they really feel like they don't have a connection with the past, so they can't feel guilt or shame for something that they think that they didn't. Does that make sense?
Right, right.
So, moving past trying to guilt or shame somebody into changing their habits or behavior, it doesn't seem like that's always an effective route to take.
Well, I'm not saying to guilt and shame.
Yeah.
I'm not saying don't go out there and guilt and shame your students, no. But
these
emotions may arise.
Yeah.
And we need to understand where they so stem. Mm-hmm. That's more what I'm saying.
So when you see, have you experienced K-12 systems using maybe guilt and shame to an extent that it just becomes ineffective anymore because you might get a change in behavior because of that initial guilt or shame, but after a while it doesn't have a lasting?
Well, you know, I've been in the K-12. I was a classroom teacher 10 years before I did a PhD and nerded out fully. So in that time, I've only done some of the diversity trainings that I've done, and I have doc students who are doing evaluations of other programs. And I do hear about some of them that focus on white privilege on that. And I can't speak because I haven't taken that as a K-12 teacher, but I do know this in my work in whiteness, that if a person is not gonna really understand from how whiteness operates, they're just gonna learn that white privilege happens, they're never gonna feel intimately tied to as to why they feel the way they do. Even apathy, which is a defensive mechanism to pull away and not deal with existing issues.
I'm curious about empathy and how that may play a role in confronting this, these emotionalities of whiteness? I don't know. I just, that's an emotion or feel as a white race we kind of lack in comparing with others, but I really know nothing about this topic. I'm just curious.
Well, we brought,
looks like maybe we're out of time.
Yeah, just like a quick response, but this could be the last one, but they're buttoning up shop here. So.
Okay, I'm just quickly, empathy has been pushed and suppressed for so long, and it's been masked in what scholars have called false empathy.
Oh.
So we're pretending to have empathy. We're pretending to have care, yet Angela Venezuela is saying we need authentic care. We're pretending we have love in teaching, but then we're asking for authentic love, you know? So Miklina Zimbalas talks about sentimentalized emotions, which aren't really emotions. They're just like what we present, because that we know that's the acceptable emotion to present. So it's time to really get down and dirty, I guess, with our own selves before we can do anything for anyone else.
Thank you so much for coming, and thank you for those watching online. That concludes our series for 2017. Upcoming, look for Harriet Sanford, president of the NEA Foundation. She'll be the next speaker in our series. And so thanks again to Dr. Cheryl Matias.